Really praying because this specific topic and verse is something that I don't feel super confident or comfortable talking about, and I will explain in a bit, but definitely we need to pray. Om Gyanatimirandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Pristaya Bhutale Shrimate Bhakti Vedanta Swamini Tinamine Namaste Saraswati Devi Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shrivasadi Gaurabhaktavrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Ram, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Thank you all so much. Please, asking for your blessings, especially of all the senior devotees, Adi Purush Prabhu, Arjun Prabhu. I don't know if you're there listening, but definitely need your blessings. Today we are reading from 10th Canto, Chapter 35, verses 16 to 17. We're in the Gopi Gita and we are hearing from the gopis. So I will read the verse and then the translation and the purport, the verses 16 to 17. And then we will talk a bit. Okay. I think this is in the meter of the Brahma Samhita, so I won't do that. I think that's what it is. So it says, Nija Padabja Dhalair Dvajavajra Nira Jankusha Vichitra Lalamanahi Vraja Bhuva Shamayankura Vrajatitena vayam svavilasa Vikshanarpitamanobhavavega Kujagatimgamitanavidama Kashmalena kavaram vasanamva. The translation, the gopis are speaking as Krishna strolls through Vraja with his lotus petal-like feet, marking the ground with the distinctive emblems of flag, thunderbolt, lotus, and elephant goad. He relieves the distress the ground feels from the cow's hooves. As he plays his renowned flute, his body moves with the grace of an elephant. Thus, we gopis, who become agitated by Cupid when Krishna playfully glances at us, stand as still as trees, unaware that our hair and garments are slackening. Purport. Here, Mother Yashoda is no longer in the company of the gopis, who are confidentially describing their conjugal attraction to Sri Krishna. It is clear from the comments of Jiva Goswami and other acharyas that the statements in this chapter were made at various times and places. This is natural since the gopis were always absorbed in thoughts of Sri Krishna day and night. I will also read the purport by Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti Thakur because it just expounds on this topic a little bit more. It says, in these verses, the gopis are no longer in the company of Mother Yashoda, which we've heard. So they freely describe their confidential conjugal attraction to Sri Krishna. And I really like Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur's purports, because he narrates as the gopis. It's very beautiful. So it says, he says, the gopis said, the soft touch of Krishna's lotus petal feet marked with conch, flag, and goad pacifies Mother Earth from the pain she feels from the hooves of the cows returning to Vraj in the late afternoon. As Krishna walks by with the gait of a maddened elephant, he agitates our hearts with lust by his playful glances, and thus we become stunned and immobilized like the trees. In our bewilderment, we fail to notice that the garlands in our hair and our garments are slipping off. On one hand, Krishna removes the distress of the earth. But for us, the beautiful-browed gopis of Vraja, he agitates our minds by glancing at us with his beautiful lotus eyes. Such is our misfortune. Especially, please pay attention to that final sentence, which I thought was really beautiful, that on the one hand, Krishna is doing, this is the gopi speaking, yeah? On the one hand, Krishna is doing this wonderful service to Mother Bhumi, right? He's relieving the distress of the earth. But for us, the gopis, he's just agitating our mind with his glances, and they end, such is our misfortune. And so I'd like to first off begin by just remembering, I don't know who was present or who was not present for the beautiful Janmashtami festival. I heard from many who attended that it was the best, most wonderful Janmashtami at the Bhakti Center they had ever attended. Champak and Vasudev, and I think it was Vasudev's idea, had this beautiful idea of turning the whole Janmashtami celebrations into a meditation on Krishna's form. And so it was so expertly done. And if you haven't heard those lectures, please, I think they were streamed. I'm pretty sure they were streamed on the live YouTube of the Bhakti Center. And so if you haven't heard them, please go and hear them, because the way it happened was that there were various devotees who spoke just a short time, like maybe 15, 20 minutes or something like this, moving from Krishna's lotus feet, which we're talking about today, and moving up Krishna's form. Yes, his lotus feet, his dhoti, his hips, his chest, his smile, his face, his flute, as such. And so different devotees came and they spoke 15, 20 minutes very concisely about Krishna's form. And it was just absolutely wonderful. It was a wonderful meditation. And it really drew us in closer to really the secret of bhakti. One of these most confidential secrets, the most confidential secret in Bhagavad Gita, right? It goes from confidential knowledge to more confidential knowledge to most confidential knowledge that is spoken about in the heart of the Gita. And this most confidential knowledge is Krishna's form. That Krishna's form is the one that we are having loving relationship with. It's the one that we are able to engage in bhakti with, right? And this is something extremely important to remember, that we can understand Krishna as Brahman, as Paramatma existing in the heart of every living being, but the highest understanding of Krishna is his perfect, most beautiful form. And this is the one, this understanding is going to bring us closer to him. So before we start digging into some of these symbols on his lotus feet, I want to remind you all, and I'm going to get into this a little bit towards the end, but it's a really confusing topic. And it's something that is really best discussed with someone who knows this topic very well. And it should be discussed not not leisurely, you know, and I'm not saying that these Bhagavatam classes are leisurely, but it is us going through the Bhagavatam, right? And so when the heart of the devotee is extremely desiring to understand these topics of rasa tattva, yes, then we should inquire deeply from someone who knows this and want to understand this. There is a beautiful book by Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, and it is called Jaiva Dharma. And maybe some of you have read it, or maybe you have heard of it, maybe you have not, but you should read it. It's really wonderful, especially the first two sections of Jaiva Dharma are really beautiful. It's a dialogue, which is really nice. So it's done in this dialogue form. It's not so much straight, heavy philosophy, even though there is a lot of philosophy in it. So it really helps us understand kind of the ABCs of our philosophy and Krishna consciousness in a very kind of easy to digest way. So I remember last year I was rereading these first two parts of Jaiva Dharma because I had read it before. And the first time I read it, when I arrived at the third part, which is Rasa Tattva, just within a few pages, I was like, I don't know what's happening. I don't know what's going on. This is really over my head. And then the second time that I read Jaiva Dharma, which was last year, I read the whole Rasa Tattva section. And still, when I read it, I was like, okay, that was a lot. I still kind of understand, but really and so this is one of those things that you can read over and over, and one should read over and over and over again to try to gain some understanding of this. And I'll read a little bit from Jaiva Dharma, but just to go into some points, but later. So in this verse, we are seeing a few things happening in this verse. One, it's important to understand what is being said in the purport, that the gopis are no longer close to Mother Yashoda, and therefore they can have these or they have this freedom to move into this bhav of conjugal attraction. I forgot to mention in the Janmashtami celebrations, when we got to the point of Krishna's flute, there was a beautiful drama of verses from the Gopi Geet, and it was just stunning. It was really, really beautiful to see this drama. So if you haven't seen it, please go see it. So in the verse, we are understanding the gopis are now more free in their own company to exude their longings. We are seeing Krishna's beautiful lotus feet and learning about different emblems on Krishna's feet. And there are a variety of emblems. It's not just these four or five that are mentioned here. And the final thing around the gopis slackening their garments and their garlands slackening. We're not going to get so much into that. I would suggest that we just understand this as one of the ecstatic symptoms of the gopis. And, you know, I spoke about this when I gave class on the very beginning of the Rasalila. I remember I gave this class at the very beginning of Rasalila, where I was really drilling this point home that we cannot think that when words like lust or etc. are utilized in these descriptions, that they have even the slightest anything to do comparison with the lust of the material world. When words like greed or jealousy or envy or anger or all of these different types of words that are used actually to describe different symptoms of the gopis. You can look in Jaiva Dharma, you can look in Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, more towards the end of Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, that is usually not studied so much, actually. It goes on to describe a lot of these ecstatic symptoms. And the words seem like, oh, jealousy and fear and anger and, you know, lust and greed. And you're reading this kind of like, what is this? And so this is not the material understanding of it. And I think that actually I'll read from Jiva Dharma now. It is said, all the bhavas, this is describing Vipralamba Bhav. Vipralamba Bhav means the bhavas that arise in separation. Yes. So there's Sambhoga, union, and there's Vipralamba, which is the bhavas that arise in separation. And so this specific chapter is dealing with, oh no, it's not. Sorry. The next chapter is dealing with Vipralamba. This is dealing with Stai Bhav and stages of Rati. Anyway, it's all about the bhavas. And Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, all the bhavas that arise in the Vraja Devis are divine in all respects and beyond the jurisdiction of logic. Therefore, it is not only difficult, but impossible to describe those bhavas thoroughly. Full stop. And I always really liked that. I turned to it today. I had my little bookmark on this page for some reason. And then he goes on to describe some of the bhavas and this and et cetera. But it's really humbling to understand that we can talk about this. We can maybe intellectually try and fit this into our heads. But actually, it is a very high level of bhakti that we can really enter into this understanding. And our best bet is to hear about these things from someone who actually has these realizations. And so that's why it feels a little bit hard to give a class like this, because I don't have those realizations. Right? I'm reading this final part of Ras Tattva Jiva Dharma like 2 or 3 times, still bewildered. But what we can do today is have a small meditation on Krishna's feet, just like we did for Janmashtami, and specifically looking at the emblems that are described here: the lotus, the goad, the flag, the thunderbolt. And a lot of these things were mentioned in Janmashtami. But it's nice. It's always wonderful to mention them again. And maybe one small story before we get into this, and it won't take long. So I realize I've been talking a lot and kind of going back and forth. I'm not really that prepared today. It's not my cup of tea. I'm usually more philosophy, and I like that kind of stuff. But I remember, in our Krishna consciousness society, we love and we worship the lotus feet of Sri Krishna. We love and we worship the lotus feet of our Gurudev. And I remember there was one fun story that happened to me, because sometimes with newer people who don't understand this attraction to lotus feet, they can get kind of taken aback. They're like, what is happening? Why are you all crazy about this, the feet and the waters and the oils and the essences that are utilized to bathe the feet, and then we're drinking that water. It's like, to someone who's new, they're just like, whoa. And I remember back in the day, when I was living in the ashram, we were having Tuesday night kirtan, which still exists, but it was very different back then. Back then, Tuesday night kirtan, we liked to bring poetry into the kirtan. We would sometimes pause the kirtan and read some poetry about what we were speaking about. And on that particular day, I had decided that I wanted to read a poem about the lotus feet, the lotus feet of Guru. And I remember Jai Jagannath told me, he was like, don't do it. Like, you're going to lose people. These are new people who have never heard of any of these things. It's gonna like this. And I was like, no, I'm gonna do it. And regardless of his warnings, I decided that I would speak about the lotus feet, I would sing about the lotus feet, and I would read a poem about the lotus feet. And of course, he was right. Everyone was so confused, and no one knew what was happening. And I was just in ecstasy, just speaking about Sri Guru's lotus feet, and it was absolutely wonderful. But these are very, the reason I mentioned this story is because these are very confidential topics. and we should speak about them with devotees. So the lotus symbol has much significance. One of the significance, I won't go into every single one of them, but one of the significances is that it signifies that Krishna's lotus feet are so soft that they can only be compared to a lotus. And because they are so soft, upon serving them, upon rendering that humble service to those beautiful, soft lotus feet, then we also become soft. Yes? And I'm going to try my best to bring a practicality to each of these meanings. When we are caught in the dryness of jnana, of vairagya, of just renunciation and this and et cetera, then we're not able to soften. And bhakti is all about being soft. Bhakti is all about softening the heart. There's this verse that I really love, and I've mentioned it many times when I give class, about the steel-clad frame that surrounds the heart. Yes, I think this is in second canto. And it is being said, you know, it is being said in this verse that the person who is not able to experience these wonderful symptoms of hair standing on end, tears flowing from eyes, when they hear the names of Krishna, when they see Krishna, that person's heart is certainly steel framed. And so our duty, our desire, not duty, our desire as devotees of Krishna is for our hearts to become soft like butter. It's for our hearts to really, really, really do away with these anarthas, or these unwanted desires, unwanted things that are blackening the heart, darkening the heart, hardening the heart. Yes, we can think about all of our stuff. You know, you don't need to think about it right now, but in general, all of our things, the baggage, the stuff that we're carrying, it weighs down the heart, right? It weighs down the heart. It makes the heart feel heavy. So just by worshiping the lotus feet of Sri Krishna, his beautiful, gorgeous, soft, like a lotus feet, then we can receive this highest benefit of our hearts over time softening. And I would definitely, you know, Kostubha Prabhu was speaking about the form, and I think also the feet. And he was mentioning that it's really important that whenever we do deity worship, we always, or whenever we look at the deity, we're instructed to always start with the feet, right? We're always instructed to start there, because it's also a sign of humility that we are understanding that we're not just going to go directly to the top, right? We are understanding that we're in a downtrodden position, that our hearts are probably not so soft, that they've been hardened by time immemorial. Yes, it is said that the jiva has been turned away from Krishna. Bhagavat vimukata, right? Turned away from Krishna from time immemorial. And this is something really interesting, because it's hard to understand what that means. Like, how can I have been turned away from Krishna from time immemorial? And you know, I'm not going to get into that whole thing, because it's a very big debate. I'm not even going to mention the debate. If you know the debate, you know. Yeah, this is one of, if you know, you know moments. I'm not even going to get into it, because I really appreciate Bhaktivinoda Thakur. You know, it's just beyond the jurisdiction of logic. And the more and more that we try to get into these debates of, oh, which came first, and how can I be turned away from time immemorial, whatever, etc., the more that our hearts will actually not become soft. And we'll be caught in this back and forth. The goad indicates that the meditation of his lotus feet brings the elephant, the mad elephant of the devotee's mind, under his control. And Krishna keeps us on the right path. And this is just a reminder, you know, Bhagavad Gita tells us very clearly, Krishna tells us very clearly, that when the mind is under the control of the self, the mind can be the best friend. And when the mind is not under the control and the guidance of the self, then the mind can become the worst enemy. And I'm absolutely sure that we all have had the experience of our mind as an enemy. I have. And it's not fun, right? Like it's really not good. You can have all the desires in the heart, but if the mind is against you, it can really just derail you. Yes. So Krishna has his goad, on his foot, just goading us back, goading the monkey mind, the rascal mind back to his protection. And that's the next one. The flag is announcing to the devotees that he gives safety and security from all sorts of fear. And this makes me think about this beautiful verse that I love to quote quite often. Bhayam dvitiya vinaveshatasyat ishadapetasya viparyayosmati, etc., which says, fear in the living entity arises. Yes, fear in the living entity arises when we turn away from Krishna. Yeah, it's that simple. Fear arises in us when we are turned away from Krishna. And then, therefore, the solution to that is to Bhagavat Unmukhata, to turn towards Krishna, right? To always remember Krishna, to never forget Krishna, to try our best. Yeah. What is the ultimate instruction of nectar of instruction? The ultimate instruction is that we should try to meditate, think about Krishna 24 hours a day, constantly, in every single moment, in everything that we do. How can I see Krishna's hand in everything that I do? How can I see Krishna's love in everything that happens in my life? And this is very hard, And that's why we need these reminders of the flag. We need these reminders of the goad, because it's very difficult, actually, to, especially, I was talking about this in a class I was giving yesterday, Ishopanishad class. It's very difficult to practice this, especially when things don't go the way that we wanted them to go. Yes. When things are going the way that we wanted, then it's easy. Oh, yes, Krishna loves me and I love Krishna and he's on my side and everything's great. And yes, it's all, I love bhakti. But when things don't go according to our plan, or there is some sort of reversal, or there is some sort of conflict or frustration or et cetera in our lives, then it is very hard to actually think and really believe Krishna has my best interests at hand, that actually this is Krishna's hand moving everything in my life exactly as he wants to bring me closer to him. Yes. I always like to quote this point from Madhurya Kadambini, a very important point that I have understood from this text by Śrīla Viśvanātha Cakravarti Thakura, which is that after initiation, pre-initiation, things work differently. And this is the philosophical understanding of our acharyas. This is not my opinion. Pre-initiation, one is subject to karma and all past life karma. And post-initiation, right, we are understanding that the guru is taking on our karma. The guru is personally involved in making sure of our delivery back to Godhead. Yes. And so then the question arises, and Srila Viśvanātha Cakravarti Thakura mentions this in Madhurya Kadambini. The question arises, well, okay, if that's the case, if I am no longer subject to the laws of karma post-initiation, then why am I still suffering? Why are bad things still happening to me? Why are, et cetera, et cetera? And the answer that is given, and I think it's a very hopeful answer, in my opinion, the answer that is given is that there are only two reasons that a devotee is still going through hardship, suffering, etc., post-initiation. The first reason is you are suffering the results of past aparad in this life or in past lives. Offenses, yes, many types of different offenses, Vaishnava aparad, etc. And I remember telling a friend this, where I was mentioning this point. I said, unless I am like with some expert, I don't know, past life Vaishnava regression specialist, like I don't know what my past life aparads are. And in this life, I am trying to avoid making any sort of aparad to any sort of devotees. like this, as we all should. And the second reason, and so I told this person that I was mentioning this, so I told him, because I don't really know that, I always go with the second reason. Yeah, I always go with the second reason. And the second reason that Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti Thakur states is that these sufferings are happen post-initiation to devotees, or these reversals, or etc., because this is Krishna personally entering into their lives to bring them ultimately closer to Him. And I always thought that that was very beautiful and very hopeful, that when some reversal or bad thing is happening in my life, I can really meditate. This is Krishna's personal hand loving me, maybe harshly, moving things in my life the way that I might not realize Krishna's plan, but Krishna's plan is there. And I'm sure we can all think about something rhetorically in our lives, so not rhetorically, what's it called? Something past in our lives, right? Something that has happened to us in the past, where we're able to see now, after the fact, that, oh yes, actually, I understand. This was actually Krishna's will. This was actually Krishna bringing me closer to Him. But maybe in the moment, and I definitely have experienced this, we're kicking and panting and screaming and crying and yelling and angry. Why, Krishna? Why are you doing this to me? And we must always remember, going back to the flag, that Krishna is our ultimate shelter. Krishna is our ultimate protection. And we must remember that even when things don't go well, can we trust that actually this is Krishna's hand personally moving things in my life to bring us ultimately closer to Him? Last but not least is the thunderbolt, Vajra. So this thunderbolt, I guess this is a nice segue from what I just spoke. It is symbolizing that Krishna, the meditation on Krishna and His lotus feet, is smashing to pieces the karmic reactions of past sins of all the devotees. And this is just wonderful. This is just absolutely wonderful that we have an opportunity, such a special opportunity in this life, to hold on to Krishna's lotus feet, to have all the past nonsense from all past lives, all these karmic reactions to all, who knows what happened in past lives, you know? I know for a fact in my life that I must have done some bad stuff, because, you know, we don't need to go into specifics, but I really meditated on that. I was like, wow, I really must have done some bad stuff, but I also must have done something really good, because I came to Krishna consciousness and, you know, I have the mercy of the devotees. But it's so absolutely wonderful that we can meditate on Krishna's lotus feet and really, really, truly believe in our hearts that our love and worship to Krishna will eradicate those things. Will eradicate those things. And even if I'm still suffering, or things are still happening, or things are not going my way, I can truly meditate on the fact that this is Krishna just simply bringing me closer to Him. Yes? Before, we're at 10 minutes. I didn't realize that I was going to talk that long, but it was actually really sweet to take a break from the intense philosophy and just speak from the heart of our love for Krishna, our love for Krishna. But one last thing that I think I will leave you all with is, because I said I promised I would, this meditation from Jivadharma. So we have to understand from a philosophical point of view that what the gopis are experiencing here are the utmost symptoms, highest symptoms of ecstasy, of rag, of ecstatic symptoms. And so for those of you that are interested in these types of things, I suggest you read Even before jumping to that last, those last parts of Nectar of Devotion, Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, to read this final section of Jivadharma, because it's explained quite nicely. But there is this Viparlamba and this Samboga. Yes, Viparlamba means the bhav arising from separation, and Samboga is union. And I was going to go into kind of like the different, there's Bhaktivinoda Thakur states that there are four different types of Viparlamba: bhav, purvarag, mana, prema, vaichitya, and pravas. And he gives explanations and examples of all of them and examples of the gopis. Yes, he's speaking of the gopis. But time is up and there's no need actually. But I would like to leave with with just a meditation for all of us, that we can have with our gurus, we can have with Krishna. That Bhaktivinoda states here that actually Viparlamba, separation, nourishes Samboga, union. And many times when the guru leaves, or Krishna feels so far away, or our loved ones, you know, our loved devotees feel so far away, we have to be very careful and wary to not fall into, you know, wallowing depression. Oh, I'm so sad, everyone left me, you know, et cetera, or whatever is going on in our life. And rather, in those moments, really, 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 really practice this essence. We can't get into the specifics of Viparlamba, but the essence of Viparlamba, that in separation, I am actually tending the field of the heart. I'm actually preparing the field of the heart to nourish my hopefully inevitable union with my guru, with my, you know, whoever it is that I'm having this feeling of separation from Krishna himself. Yeah. And so this is very, very nice, and it's a very beautiful meditation. And I'm going to stop there because I do want to hear from people, and we don't need to go into philosophy. Okay, Hare Krishna. Okay, Ananda Bihari Prabhu.
Sure, Chandra.
We can't hear you much, Ananda Bihari Prabhu, so I think I'm just going to call on people, if that's okay, because I think your connection is a bit off. So I saw Bhima.
Sure, go ahead.
I saw Bhima Prabhu raise his
hand. Can't hear you. Sorry.
Haribol Prabhu, wonderful class. It's really nice to take that deep dive into understanding what's going on. Though some of us, especially myself, being simple, a simple field hand, I would just like, I actually wanted to hear from other people first, but I just wanted to say that for those of us who become troubled by the so-called sophistication of the relationships, that, you know, we notice that Prabhupada over and over, I don't think there's a single purport where Prabhupada doesn't mention the two words, devotional service. That when we actively participate, whether we intellectually understand, but when we actively participate in such simple activities, such as chanting, dancing, and feasting, when we actively go out of our way to find ourselves in the association of devotees like yourself, Prabhu, that all this stuff is made apparent, and we are made aware of the true import and treasure of this relationship, of Krishna's relationship with his pure devotees. And then, of course, by virtue of being in the area, we get a little bit of that shine ourselves. We enjoy the fact that we're hearing about the pure devotees enjoying seeing the ecstasy of whether it be our acharya or the devotees dancing, our brothers and sisters dancing in kirtan. Yesterday, spontaneously, myself and three other devotees went out for a little late night picnic, and we were actually in a small little restaurant, vegetarian restaurant, home cooked meal type of thing. We were the only people there. It wasn't even a restaurant. It's more like a little cafe. But anyways, one of the devotees spontaneously, we were talking to him about we heard that you sing, blah blah blah, and he goes, would you like to hear? And he turned on his phone and had some, you know, Bengali bhajan in the background, and he started singing beautifully, just wonderful singing, and but very ecstatic, just like spontaneous. And so in the restaurant, we just burst out into kirtan, and during that kirtan, it was like everything was understood. Everything was understood. It was understanding that simultaneously, though Krishna himself might not be there, that Krishna was there. Mm-hmm. So simultaneously not there, but he was there amongst mm-hmm. us, singing. We were chanting as if we were in the middle of a field, all four of us. And then we had a wonderful meal that was blessed by the kirtan. So that for all of us who become troubled by the complications or the categorizations of the, you know, different types of rasas and relationships, and whether I'm still stuck in my karma or whether this thing is happening to me because of my karma. If we just find ourselves chanting, dancing, or feasting mm-hmm. as much as possible, we never have to worry about any of these things. If it's spinning around in your head, just go find an engagement, mm-hmm. an active engagement, and Krishna will from within answer all your questions, and it will become revealed to you exactly where you're at and where exactly where you need to go. So thank you very much, Prabhu, for helping us out in that manner. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Thank you so much, Prabhu. I just wanted to comment on many of the things that you said, because I think it was very beautiful. And it's a really nice meditation to remember that Krishna consciousness is simple as well. It's also very complex, and you can get into it and all the things, but it's also very simple. And I've been reading a book called the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu Bindu, which is Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur's commentary on Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. And he's stressing so much in his commentary, as it is stressed in Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, that the essence of our bhakti is coming from association with sadhu sangha. And how do we get sadhu sangha? By chanting and feasting and loving Krishna and just being there. And then through the mercy, sadhus will come into our lives. We'll hear from them. We'll hear their realizations. Our bhakti will come more, and then we'll be more enthusiastic and encouraged to serve better, and then we'll serve better, and we'll have that mercy, and sadhus will come into our life, and etc. And it's just this beautiful, beautiful thing, because I have been around many people who really get really heady about these kinds of things. And it's very usually younger people. And it's really clear that there's no realization. They just want to know. They want to know everything. And I always tell them, you know, just do your seva, you know, find something nice to do and love Krishna, and that's enough, you know. Like these really more transcendental, kind of esoteric, that's the word I wanted to use, topics, yeah, that realization will come to you when it's time, and those sadhus will come to you when it's time. There's no rush. It's not, you know, as devotees, we're not thinking, oh, you don't understand what prema vaichitya Vipralamba Bhav is, wow, you must be really off here. You know, it's like, and if there's a devotee who's treating you like that, and that speaks a lot about, you know, where they're at. And really our heart should be, as Bhima Prabhu has said, just let me do my seva. Let me chant these beautiful holy names. Let me really put my heart into all of this and trust that these realizations will come at the correct moment. I think that's such a beautiful meditation. Thank you so much, Bhima Prabhu.
Vinisha, do you still have your question or comment?
Yeah, but I see that it's 8:01. I don't know if the conch is going to sound. I don't know if you have time afterwards to stay with our afterglow.
Let's see what it has in store. Let's go for it.
Let me just go for it. Okay, well, it's a little bit long. I have three things because it was so rich what you said. And also, I don't know that if you were here at our class yesterday, I was officially empowered by Adi. Oh, there we go.
Let's leave it for the
All right, afterwards. Thank you so much.
I'll stay. Okay, I'm gonna just do it myself. I was waiting for someone else to do it, but I will do it. I'm very excited to hear Venetia's three-part question.
Oh. I'll try to be quick. So again, such a rich class that I have three things that came up. There were so many things that came up from your class. It was excellent. And the first thing was just to share this. I'm so intrigued by this conjugal taste, you know, this feeling that the gopis have, and kind of the sense that it's like a double-edged sword. And on one hand, I, in my very neophyte understanding, understand that the Srimad Bhagavatam was written because there were many excellent Vedic texts, but there hadn't been something written that really pulled us in through all our very human emotions. That was the goal, really. Every single part of this is to attract us to Krishna through hook and by crook in every way that human beings experience attraction. And you know, and I think about the scenes like when Mother Yashoda was churning butter and her hair is coming loose and the flowers are falling. There's just such, you know, that maternal feeling, or when he's in the, Krishna's in the fields with his friends and he puts his head in their laps, and you just feel the feelings of maternal affection. Not that I'm a mother, but you can feel it. And, you know, friendship. And then when you get to this, you know, anyone who has had a lover, you know the feeling that is being spoken about here. You know, when you become disheveled and you don't even know it because you're just so in love and aroused and excited and out of your mind. And the Srimad Bhagavatam is drawing us in on that emotion. It wants us to come in on that emotion because we understand it and we know it and we can use it to become attracted to Krishna. But then the other edge of the sword is if you go too far. And one of my very, very immature qualities is that if somebody gives me a dare, I'm like, oh yeah, I'm going to do it. And so I saw that there was a book by the author that you were mentioning, whose name I'm terrible at pronouncing, Srila Vishnavanatha Thakur. And I won't tell you the name, won't tell the class the name of it, so you won't be tempted like I was, that he wrote this book about, like, he expands on the rasa dance, like what actually happens behind the scenes, you know, in between the verses that we are received in the Bhagavatam. And I was reading it and I was like, oh, this is so beautiful. This is so beautiful. Oh, wow, this is so beautiful. And then I was chanting like even weeks later, and these unbelievable images of lust came into my mind around Krishna and the gopis. But it might as well, I mean, amongst friends here have been like slightly pornographic. Like it was, because it's very detailed. And I was like, oh my goodness, this is the other edge of the sword. If you're not ready, and I am clearly not ready to understand this the way it is meant to be understood, which is transcendental spiritual attraction, you can so quickly fall into the physical. And it happened. But nonetheless, I don't want to be repelled by it. You know, I don't want to be like, oh, I, you know, we can't talk about this. And it's, you know, he's eight and it's not really happening. No, it's happening. But we have to approach it so carefully. And so that was just a personal experience of this. So be careful, my friends. Yeah. And then the second thing that that I wanted to say was about the lotus feet. And I was, you know, at the morning service maybe a month or so ago. And, you know, after the morning service, we sit down and we chant our rounds, and I was chanting my rounds, and I was getting very distracted in my mind, more so than usual. So I actually got up and started walking around the temple, and I went over to Srila Prabhupada and chanted by him to try to settle my mind. And I closed my eyes. I opened my eyes and Radhanath Swami was standing right there by himself. And it was like being struck by lightning. I just dropped to the floor. Like, I don't know the man at all. And I just dropped to the floor on my knees in front of him and had my head on the ground. And I just, he was standing there, obviously, you know, paying his obeisances to Srila Prabhupada. So he was there for, you know, some minutes. And so I just peeked up, opened my eyes, and I looked at his feet. And they were, I am not kidding, the most beautiful feet I have ever seen. And I'm a New Yorker and I get pedicures and I see lots of feet. And these feet, and I'm not talking physically, although they were very beautiful physically, feet, they were effulgent. And I'm not kidding, I had no reason to think that, but they were literally glowing. And I just felt like I wanted to stay there at his feet, that I could stay there at his feet because they were so worshipable. So just wanted to share that very real realization. And then, I mean, not like a realization, it was just a moment. But then the third thing, what you said about devotees who are initiated and then experience some great misfortune or something troubling. And I understand that our own Doyal, who had that rollerblading accident, is in quite a lot of pain, and there's been a lot of complications. I've not spoken to him. I just hear this, that it's, you know, it's very painful what happened to him. And, you know, he told us in that he wants to use this experience to understand how he can become closer to Krishna, which I just think is so beautiful and admirable. But I also just hope we can just continue And Damodar Priya, you know, asked us many weeks ago to pray for him. And I just want to reiterate, I hope we can pray for him and pray for his recovery and whatever he needs, that, you know, over time, that we can all be there for him, because I've sensed that he's going through a lot of pain. But I just am so inspired by his wanting to, like you said, use this to understand his past offenses, things that need to be cleaned out of his heart, and that he gets there. So Hare Krishna, thank you very much.
Krishna, thank you so much, Nisha, for all of that. I'll go quickly through them. Number one, first of all, thank you for sharing your heart and being vulnerable. We're amongst devotees, so we can talk about all these esoteric things. And, you know, sometimes when you get together with devotees, be like, I had this dream, and I had someone appear to me in this dream, and I had this vision, and I saw this, and I saw that, and it's really beautiful and really, really wonderful, but amongst ourselves. The first thing about, wanting to jump into really esoteric texts like the one that you're mentioning before perhaps the qualification, I don't even want to use that word, but before perhaps the heart is ready for that, right? Because one of the main steps in our Krishna consciousness is called anartha nivritti, which means ridding the heart of unwanted desires. And so, yes, it's very beautiful, and to read all these extremely detailed descriptions, and it's actually part of our, I remember the point I wanted to make, it's actually part of our bhakti lineage and practice to, you know, this last chapter of Jiva Dharma is called entering Leela. What is my part to play in this Leela? What is my spiritual identity? Who am I really? You know, if I am to go back to Godhead and go back to the spiritual world, what is my part to play there? Am I a gopi? I'm probably not a gopi. But like, am I a piece of grass in Goloka Vrindavan? I hope so. That would be nice, you know, but what is my part to play in all of that? And how do we, this is very, one, esoteric, and two, hot topic in ISKCON in terms of people having different opinions about this. So I'm not going to get into it so much, because I'm not one for getting into like that kind of stuff. But basically, the principle is there. Who am I? What is my spiritual identity? And what part do I have to play in Krishna's Leela? And why is he attracting me to him? How does he want me to play things out? And so this is something very beautiful. And I guess what I will leave you with in terms of that is that my, you know, Jai Jagannath, my very dear friend and teacher, he trained me, always has this maxim that he likes to share, that the evolution of inquiry precedes the evolution of being, which means that the more that I advance my questions and the longing of my heart and what I am really wanting to know and asking, that needs to come before the actual realization of my being and the evolution of my being. So I can jump to many texts, and I've seen many people do it. Like all of a sudden they're reading these like super esoteric things, and they're talking to me and they're telling me all these things. And I'm just like, wow, wonderful, you know? And then I've also seen it go, you know, as such, because the foundation was not there, if that makes sense. And so it is important. Those texts are there for anyone who wants to read them, but it's also important to hear about them from someone who's realized, because they will give us that understanding that, yeah, the what goes on between the gopis and Krishna, ineffable, you know, it's not, we once again, to quote Bhaktivinoda Thakur, these bhavas are in all respects beyond the jurisdiction of logic. So in our mind, we might be thinking, oh, this sounds like an experience that I had, or I'm thinking it's like this, but it's just not, you know, full stop. And so how do we understand what it is actually? We need to hear from someone who understands. what it is, not just us reading the text, because then we will put our understanding. That's why it is always said that hearing is better than reading. Hearing from someone is better than reading, because when I'm hearing their realization. When I'm reading, I am imposing my thoughts and realization onto the text. Thing number two, Radhanath Swami's feet, I think, was thing number two. Yes, his feet are amazing, and I have a picture of them, and they're glowing and epic, and I love them. The end. And the last one, about Doyal, yes, please, we should all send our prayers to him. And also, you know, we read about death a lot in our Shastra. And really, so much of our bhakti is preparing for ourselves for those final moments. Can I truly be in Krishna consciousness? Can I truly love Krishna and not more than love, and more than love, not be resentful towards Krishna? Because when some reversal happens in life, I break my shoulder, I break my this, I lost my job or whatever, it's so easy for the uncontrolled mind to become angry. How could you do this to me, Krishna? I gave you everything. I did this. And now this is how you treat me? It's done, you know? Or how could these devotees do this to me? What, you know, whatever conflict might be going on, etc. And so really, these reversals in life, whether they be physical, emotional, mental reversals, they're blessings for us to be able to practice Krishna consciousness in those very real moments. Because the most real moment of death is a reality. Yes, it is a reality, and it will happen for every single one of us. And can I be Krishna conscious in those moments?
Happy Monday, everybody. Happy Monday, everybody.
Exactly. Happy Monday, everyone. But it's always important to think about these things, even on a Monday. I'm going to stop there. I hope I addressed all your points, Vinisha, and thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you, Kishor Chandra. Vinisha, can you say Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur again?
Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur.
That was good.
Nice. Vinisha. Yeah, I see Adipurusha Prabhu is tempted to say something. Maybe it's how wonderful is Krishna, maybe not. We don't know. One line, Adipurusha Prabhu. Don't crash your car, though. Das can unmute you. Give it to Das.
Hare Krishna. How wonderful is Krishna? Wonderful is Krishna. The Krishna consciousness isn't just in a book, it's experiential. Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Bhakya Mama Bhajanti. Only by devotional service can I be understood. It's good to hear from somebody, it's good to read it in a book, and these amazing pastimes, but like Bhima was putting up that point, if we just engage in devotional service, then we would directly perceive and experience Krishna consciousness and Krishna. You know, it's so cool. There's a thing on a website where you go to this website and they describe all the different things that they make in this restaurant. But it's not like going to the restaurant and having dinner, right? Mm-hmm. Definitely it's a step in the right direction, and it'll help you get closer to that experience, and your mouth might water, but it's nothing like having dinner. So we recommend devotional service, which means, Krishna, what do you want me to do? Not just do something for, we feel like, to Krishna, but the closer we get to that Kurukshetra moment where Arjuna, after all the Bhagavad Gita, goes, okay, I get it. What do you want me to do? And then Krishna tells him. And then he's embroiled in the battle, and he's completely above and beyond any kind of attachment, and it says, forget all attachment, aversion, abandon all desire for fear, for, you know, our own comfort and safety. And there it is, transcendental position. Love emerges. We see these people coming out to feed the homeless, and a lot of them are guests. They've never had any philosophy or anything, but when they come out there and they start to do it, then they change. They start going, oh, this is for you, this is for you, and this is for you, and this is for you, this is for you, this is for you. And they're getting like this, there's the Vaishnava creed, I believe in Lord Krishna, the cause of all causes, and all that is, all pervasive and locally manifest. I believe in the miracle of devotional service. God's own internal spiritual energy, fully manifest in the spiritual master and the sound of Krishna's precious holy name. So how wonderful is Krishna that he gives us access to devotional service? Like Mother Padarajan was saying, I was thinking this is happening to me. No, it's not happening to me. It's happening for me. So there's a shift in consciousness, and we hope Dayal Gauranga will go through this experience in a perfect consciousness by the grace of Radha Swami. And I'm sure he will. Okay, I'll go to Prabhupada. I'll talk too much, huh? Thank you.
Thank you, Adi Purusha Prabhu. Thank you, Kishor Chandra Prabhu. I'm inspired to open, in my next life, I'll open a restaurant. I'll call it Kurukshetra. And I'll put Adi's face on the logo.
Have a food fight. Okay, Hare Krishna.
Okay, Hare Krishna, everybody. Kishor Chandra, wonderful class. Your classes are getting better and better. I don't know where you're getting this, probably from Maharaj's lotus feet. That's my guess. But it's so wonderful, so nourishing, so spot on and bona fide. Thank you, Prabhu. Wonderful class. Thanks, everyone, for participating. Have a wonderful Monday. Remember, we're all going to face this test. But let's keep the smile on. Keep your book open. Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur took the time to write it all up for us. Let's take advantage. Thank you. Good seeing everybody. Hare Krishna.